This episode of iFanboy is brought to you by GoDaddy, Netflix, and Squarespace. Hey, welcome to another episode of iFanboy. I'm Ron, and I'm here at the San Diego Comic-Con. I'm at the Image Comics booth. And here at the San Diego Comic-Con, we had a chance to sit down with Robert Kirkman, one of our favorite writers. And it was on the eve of a big news about Robert. He had just became an Image partner. He's got an Invincible animated series coming out through MTV. And then here at the San Diego Comic-Con, they announced that he's going to be writing the big Image United crossover next year, where all the Image founders are going to be drawing their own characters in one crossover book. It was huge news, big buzz of the convention. So we were lucky enough to get some time with Robert. We sat down, we talked about that project, as well as Invincible, Walking Dead, a whole bunch of other stuff. So enjoy Robert Kirkman, as we always do. So I'm here with Robert Kirkman, and where are we?
We're in the posh MTV meeting room.
The press junket, I was told, is the press junket.
This is the press junket.
We got access to Mr. Kirkman. He's gotten so big that we need to go through people.
Stop it. I can crush you now. It's more fun on the convention floor, but yeah. Now you know people won't be crowding around.
Right,
and stuff.
Yeah, it's a little quieter.
Now we're doing it. Now there's light fixtures of some kind. They've got this taped to the wall. It's totally awesome.
Exactly. So that's one of the reasons why we're here. So the
interview comes with t-shirts.
T-shirts. I didn't know that. T-shirt.
Or whatever. They went all out. So I mean, that was really cool. So
so MTV has released the Invincible animated thing, series. It's gotten a lot of mainstream press on the New York Times and things like that. So,
should I not have film here?
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Well, that's how we do it here. That's how we do it here at the MTV press. There we go. All right. No, don't put that on camera.
So tell us about the series. How did it come about? Like,
Well, MTV contacted me, and they contacted my manager, and my manager contacted me. I really don't remember. No. I have no damn clue. But sorry, my gum is slowly falling down the glass now.
We're gonna sell that on eBay.
That's like a. Anyway, sticky hands or something. But MTV 2 is going to be airing it on the old television. So that's cool.
Very cool.
All my family in Eastern Kentucky that watches MTV 2 will be thrilled. But
MTV 2 big in Kentucky? Or?
Yeah, the coolest thing is you can download it on a musket. So a lot of my neighbors are going to be watching it. Yeah. But it's going to be awesome. Oh, this musket. This is like the future. It's all about reaching a new audience, right. You know, and like 14-year-old assholes that don't read comics, that only watch MTV or only sit online all day, that would never even in a million years to think about, you know, cracking open a comic and going, oh, I'm going to see what's going on in this thing, are totally going to watch this. And, you know, they may like it, they may not like it, I don't know, but, you know, it's increasing awareness on Invincible. It's, and hopefully a percentage of those people will give comics a try. I mean, not just Invincible, you know. Right. I mean, anything that gets the medium out there, right. You know. I mean, they got people handing out those iTunes cards here at Comic-Con. I'm getting them, like, every day. Someone's like, hey, free Invincible on MTV. And I'm like, oh, okay, or iTunes. Oh. But I'm like, oh, wow, thanks. Because I do it right in front of them.
Right. So they're like, just step on it.
I'll just go, get out of here. You know, that's always fun. You okay there?
I'm okay, I went with it. I rolled into it.
But, they're getting the word out. Yeah. And that's what's important. And I think it's really cool. It's cool seeing the comic like that. So I'm going to try and talk as long as I can without you saying anything.
Here, you just take the mic and I'm going to go.
This is how we did it last time. This is great. So how long have you guys been in business? That's
great. I'll take that back now. So this isn't your first kind of foray in animation. The Battle Pope thing happened.
Battle Pope's at Spike. Yeah. That's like their second highest downloaded original content thing. It's right behind like 3-second clips of jiggling boobs. And so, like,
how can you compete with that?
When it's jiggling boobs, battle pope, other stuff, like, I gotta say, that's a bit of a feather in my cap. So, because I mean, I go there and I'm like, I want to see how this battle pope stuff turned out, but there's a jiggling boob video that I need to watch. And then I watch about 10 of those, and then I go back to bed, and then I never end up
with,
yeah. So that's why we're number two. But I mean, it's doing really well online, and, you know, people seem to like it. I like it, you know, so.
Yeah.
So actually, to be frank, we weren't going to talk to you this convention, because we talked at the Seattle Con recently, but then the past couple of months, you're all over the news. Image partner, dude.
Like, glad that happened. Otherwise, I wouldn't be talking to you guys. MTV would have gone.
Well, we've
talked to him far too much.
Too much.
But far too much. You guys get letters now? Kirkman again, huh?
But so, you know, everybody knows your kind of story about, growing up so much like we did, reading Rob Liefeld and Jim Lee and all those guys, and being an Image fan, and now you're one of them. I mean, what's that like?
I was talking to Jim Valentino about this last night. I'm name dropping now. But I've known these guys for like 5 years now. You know, like, I've been to most of their houses. You know, I've met their family. The time for that was when I was interviewing Larson for the first time for some website that my friend started, you know, back when I was like 21, you know, like,
I don't know what that's like at all.
Well, that's when I was, yeah. Well, I had a friend that was putting together a website, and that's how I met Larson. He was like, oh, we're doing a Larson interview. And I was like, no, I'm doing the Larson interview for you. I didn't even do anything for a site. Yeah. But there's somewhere out there, there is a 3-hour tape of me talking to Eric Larson for the first time.
Hours.
No, yeah, he kept talking, and I kept asking questions. It was one of the only times he's been interviewed by somebody who's read like every issue of Dragon and everything he's ever done. And so, like, he would say something, and I'd correct him, and he'd go, "Wow!" And like, you know, I mean, no, it's I need to find that tape, because it is going to be totally silly, like me going, so anyway, I like that Finn, that's how I sound all day Sunday here. The time for that has passed. I know all these guys, and, you know, now it's just like, fuck you. Yeah. Get out of here. Or screw you. You guys going to edit that in?
No, it's the internet.
Oh, okay.
Fuck yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
So we're at the big Image panel the other day, where they announced the Image United project.
In the audience.
Yeah, I was kind of off to the side. Well, we didn't want to bother, you know, your moment in the sun. So big, huge company crossover, and you're at the helm writing it. Are you worried about that book?
No. Are you sure?
No.
Because the track record is...
I'm not worried at all.
Okay.
I'm really not.
Yeah.
It's going to be hard.
Yeah.
But it's not going to be a case where in December we go... Huh. We should probably get started.
Okay.
You know, the time when we went, huh, we should probably get started, has passed.
Good.
And so, you know, as soon as I get back from the con, it's, you know, pedal to the metal, and phone call, and, you know, come on, Todd, it's just a face, get that done, you know. Just finish it out.
It's
just, you know,
a mask
out.
Even. It's not even a mask.
He's in the background of this panel. You can do it. Get that page off. Come on. But we've got a whole system worked out. I mean, there's going to be a notated script that has a list of everyone that needs to get it, and, you know, their addresses are going to be readily available, and we're just going to have people these 4 pages of this issue go to this guy, and these 6 pages, and, you know,
because they're all drawing their characters on the page together.
It's going to be like, well, there's 8 pages in this issue that everyone has to work on, and so those are the priority pages, and we're getting them to people, but we've planned this. We've planned this out, and we know what we're doing, and it's going to be cool. No one has ever done anything like this before, and that is what excites me, and that's what Image Comics is, and that's why I'm here. You know, anytime that you can say no one has ever done this before, you know, that's what excites me.
Yeah.
And so, you know, and that's Image Comics.
Yeah. Well, that's what's interesting about Image, because there's really almost 2 images these days. There's the images that of, you know, this
3 or 4 or 5. I mean, that's why right. Image is Image.
Right,
you know,
yeah.
You can do The Walking Dead, which is... such a departure from anything that they did in the early days. And, you know, and you can do Bomb Queen and you can do, you know, the sword and, you know, it doesn't matter. Right. You know, it's a television network. Right. Is what it is. You know, you can have game shows and you can have the news and you know, it's just, right. It's not just one thing. So,
yeah. Cool. So now with your, you know, this commitment to Image, is you're pretty, the days of working for Marvel or DC or anything pretty much over? You're just going to stick with Image or?
Yes. No, I have no, you know, I'm, you know, I had the Wolverine itch. I had the Spider-Man itch. I wrote those guys. I had a good time doing it. Everyone at Marvel, totally awesome. Yeah. You know, I had a great time working with them. You know, Marvel is an awesome, awesome place to work, but the icons have their gatekeepers. You know, there are super talented guys out there making those comics awesome. And I love those comics. I read Marvel and DC books. Everyone reads Marvel and DC books. Yeah. And there's not enough people out there doing their own things. Yeah. You know, there's not enough people out there creating their own comics and doing new stuff. I mean, there are, but once people hit a certain level, they seem to stop. Right. And I want to be out there saying, you know, no, you know, this is what we, you know, this is what we're supposed to be doing. Right. You know, if we, you know, hitch our wagon to Spider-Man for the rest of our life, you know, we're not going to be around in 100 years, you know, and this is time to start putting some new blood into the industry. And so that's what I'm after. You know, that's what excites me. That's what interests me. And, you know, I'm in a position where my books at Image are successful enough that I don't have to do Marvel work. Right. And I got a 2-year-old at home. And the thought of doing both, you know, and then sitting there when he's 10 going, yeah, I did not change enough poopy diapers. I don't know why I did that. Like, you know, no, this is it for me. This is awesome. I'm so excited. So
are you going to be, I mean, you've already kind of with Brit and with, you know, some of the other books, you've kind of sort of branch out. So where you're not just writing, or are you going to be building kind of like a little studio, kind of like Valentino or Silvestri or that sort of thing? Is there going to be like the Kirkman corner of the Image universe or more so than it is now?
Anything I started would not be as prominent or recognizable as the Image Comics brand. Right. And so right now I'm just going to continue like I have been doing, working under the Image Comics brand. That could change. That may never change. But right now, you know, I'm just doing Image Comics. There's not going to be a Kirkman Corner or whatever.
Yeah, a little Kirkman.
But it would be called Kirkman Corner.
Yeah, with a K, right?
This episode of iFanboy is brought to you by GoDaddy.com. At GoDaddy, you can get web hosting that includes 99.9% uptime, 24/7 support, and free access to Hosting Connection, the place to install over 30 free applications sure to help you get the most from your hosting plan and website. .com names as low as $1.99, plus world-class hosting, fast and easy website builders, and much more. Head over to GoDaddy.com and use coupon code iFanboy to get 10% off your next purchase. Get your own piece of the internet with GoDaddy.com. And Netflix. With Netflix.com, you can rent over 90,000 DVD titles online, including Blu-ray titles, with free shipping both ways to your home. Netflix plans start at $4.99 and up, and as a new member, you can get a no-risk 2-week free trial membership. So check it out at www.netflix.com/iFanboy, and don't forget to type the www when you type in that URL. That's www.netflix.com/iFanboy. And Squarespace. Squarespace is a new platform to help you build websites. Whether you need to build a blog, a portfolio, a personal website, or a business website, Squarespace.com makes it really simple. It's a hosted solution, so you don't need to worry about servers or hosting or code or anything like that. It's really easy to use and customize the website. Lots of drag and drop features. No HTML or CSS knowledge is really necessary. Although if you do know that stuff, you can use it. I've used Squarespace, and it's really easy to use, and it makes building websites super, super easy. You can build a site in seconds flat. So head over to squarespace.com, and if you use coupon code iFanboy when signing up, you'll get a 10% discount for the life of your membership at Squarespace. That's squarespace.com. Check it out.
So that's it. Why is this guy standing in the background? Why aren't you both interviewing me? Like, come around. People don't know. It's not just us.
I read the new Walking Dead trade, number 8. Thank you.
You've been dying to do that for years now, haven't you?
Spitshine. I like this Kirkman Spitshine before the con gets started. I read the Walking Dead number 8 trade when it came. You know, I bought it when it came out. I read it like 3 a.m.
You want a chair?
To finish. No, I'm all right. I was a catcher in high school, so I kind of I'm used to sitting like that. And
it's more of a pitcher.
And I finished it, and I wondered, what is wrong with Robert Kirkman that he wrote this horribly amazing story? Because it ends, that was when it ends, like, completely violently in everyone. And at 3 a.m. when I read it, it's like, I don't want to leave my bedroom. I might go outside and get horribly murdered, you know? I'm like, Did you just want to wipe the slate clean? Is that what happened at the end?
Yeah, well, that was something that had been planned for a while, and so people are like, what happened, man?
Wait, I haven't read it yet. What the fuck are you doing?
Leave the room. What are you? He's totally like running out of the room. I'm not gonna spoil anything.
Okay, right.
That was something that was planned for a long time. It was something I was always working toward, and so I always knew it was coming.
Change the paradigm of the series.
Exactly. Sometimes people in Walking Dead die. That's the spoiler.
I've got to admit, because what happens is that I'm such a freak that I will stick to the format. So Josh got me the hardcover. Mm-hmm. So I'm on hardcovers. So it takes, you know how everybody complains waiting for the trade and all that kind of stuff? I'm like the slowest of them all, so I'm waiting for the fourth hardcover to catch up.
That'll be out in October. Yeah, so it's not too bad. Yeah. It's not like other books where it's like the hardcover's like a year later or whatever. Yeah, But I didn't have anything going on at the time. Maybe like 4 years ago when I plotted that, like my wife had punched me or something, and I was just like, oh. I don't know.
The other thing about Walking Dead is it's one of the few books that constantly sales go up and up every month according to what we read in the reports. But, I mean, do you ever sit and wonder, how is this happening? Or are you just, you're just lucky?
I don't like talking about it because it's the silliest, it's the coolest thing in the world. I mean, every time sales figures come in and, we're always like, in the early days, it was like 1,000 copy jump, and we're like, what the heck, And now, it's, a few hundred here, and then, some issues it'll be like 26 copies,
But still up and up. Usually book comes out, big splash, and then every month's a little lower.
But
Walking Dead is the opposite.
And we have months where it'll drop, we'll have an issue that just, some retailer was like, oh, I don't know, screw this, or something. But, and it always, kicks back up. And with issue 50 now, we're selling higher than we've ever sold. And, I tell you, people complain about variant covers, but we did that variant cover for 50, and we sold 5,000 extra copies. So it was like, what the heck,
Variant covers for everyone.
Yeah, there's going to be a variant cover on every issue now. But, we have a little bit of integrity, so that's not going to happen.
It must be really gratifying since it's your personal story. Successful.
I set out to do long-running stories that I was going to be able to do for a long time, because, Savage Dragon was my favorite book, and, I always read Spider-Man and stuff, and, I always wanted to be that guy. I wanted to be, I wanted to be Peter David on the Hulk for, 75 years or however long it was, 74, right? I don't know. But to be able to actually do it, and with two books, it's awesome.
Is there an end point in mind for either story, or do you have a vague idea of where it's going to finish, or are you just going?
I think Brian K. Vaughan is silly. I don't know. I think, just like, oh, why the last man? It's a dope, done. Bye. I'm having too much fun. It's not even the sales success. I would kiss any fan that was like, I'll buy your book, give me a kiss. Even if I didn't want to, I'd be like,
Ron, do you want a kiss?
I guess. All right. That's fine. All right. I owe you. I'm really, really grateful to everyone that buys that book, because this is all I've ever wanted to do. And I'm writing issue 50. And I can say, unless something catastrophic happens, we're making it to 100. We're going to make it to 75. We're going to make it to 150 if things, hold on. And just, that's amazing. And so, now it's just up to me to, keep it from sucking, because I don't want this to be crappy.
When do the aliens land, though?
That's the funniest joke. When we started out the book and, oh, people, issue 12, people are like, oh, how long's it going to last? Well, I don't know. It's going to start sucking at 75, and we'll put the aliens in, and then it'll be funny. And so it was always like, issue 75, that's when it's going to jump the shark, and aliens arrive, and it'll be crazy. And now it's like 75's like right around the corner, And so I think I'm actually going to do a backup in 75 that's going to be I haven't told these guys, but I want to do a backup that's like laid out by Larson and inked by Otley, just like that cover to 50, where the aliens arrive and it's them like shooting lasers at him and shit, and fighting with zombies and stuff, like maybe like 12 pages or something, because that'd be funny.
We heard a rumor that you actually pitched it as an alien story, and that's how you got it in the door.
Yeah, that's a very unfortunate story. Because, one, it kind of makes me look deceitful. That's never good.
We thought it made you look clever.
Thank you. clever by deceit. But it's just not it's not Jim Valentino's shining moment, and Jim Valentino's a friend of mine, you know? But, like, that's how people take it, and that is not the case whatsoever. Mm-hmm. It was a funny anecdote that I used to tell, and then he called me up and was like, what the heck, man? And I was like, yeah, wow, sorry. I'm totally misrepresenting that story. But basically, I came to him with a black and white Walking Dead exactly as it is. Here's Walking Dead, you know? And he was like, yeah, no, I don't know, man. A black and white zombie book. And people now go, come on. But like Julie Schwartz or Will Eisner totally turned down Superman. You know, it's just one of those things that happen. And to come at him with a black and white zombie book after Tech Jacket had failed and Capes had, I think it was before, I don't know. But some kind of, it was right after Tech Jacket was like kind of limping along and my Super Patriot miniseries did okay, but not that well. I mean, it's not like I was a bankable creator. And there's no zombie books. None. And the few that had happened, you know, like, failed miserably, you know? And so, yeah, rightly so. He was like, no, this needs a hook. There's got to be something to this. This is not a bankable thing. And, you know, and like, I lied to him. You know, I said, oh, well, here's the thing. The zombies are on Earth because aliens are invading and they are creating zombies on Earth to weaken the infrastructure of society so that when they come in...
Swoop right in, easy to take over.
Yeah, it's like humans are like, fucking zombies, shit! And then aliens are... You know, that'll be a Bruckheimer movie like a year from now. But yeah, I mean, it's a silly thing. But
how old were you when you did this?
When I did the pitch? Yeah. I'm not... It was 2002, so I was like 23, something like that.
So when he said that and you dreamed of the alien, was that like on the fly on the phone? Like, oh, well, here it is. Or was that something that actually was kicking around in your head? Or was that like you were scrambling to save the pitch?
I think it was on the fly on the phone. Like I was just like, aliens, I don't know. But it could have been an email. I don't remember. But it was probably something I sat down and was like, and then spent like 2 weeks coming up with. But he was like, something to that. And he approved the book. And first issue came out, and Eric Stevenson, who was the marketing director at the time, who's now the publisher, he said, starting marketing, kids. You'll be the publisher one day. But he goes, yeah, man, the first issue, that thing came in, I read it, and that's really good, man. That's a really good first issue. I really like that. So I didn't see any hints about the alien stuff, though. Is that something that did I miss something, or is that coming in later, or what? And I was like, "There's no aliens in this book." And he goes, "It's probably better for it."
You know? That's good.
And I never told Valentino. So like Valentino found out when I did an interview, I guess. And I was like, "Aliens!" You know. So.
But at that point, it was successful enough for us,
you know,
right?
I mean, Jim Valentino was an excellent publisher. He was the guy because Invincible. Yeah, he saved Invincible. And the thing about the Walking Dead story is that it's funny. Right. But, like, he did the exact right thing that a publisher should do. It was not a bankable concept. And I did what a creator should do. I cared about my book, and I fucking lied. So, you know, that's fine, whatever. But, I mean, he really had a big hand in saving Invincible because the stuff between Invincible and Omni-Man was not going to happen until issue 25. And he was like, kid... Ain't gonna be no 25 unless you make this book cooler, you know? And I was like, yeah, okay. Because, like, the original last page to issue 7 was you just panned out and all the Guardians of the Globe were dead. Mm. And then I changed it to Nolan and, you know, and then we went on and did everything in issue 11 and the book started, you know. So Jim's a great guy and, you know, excellent publisher. So it's a funny story, but
he's.
Unfortunate side effects every now and then.
Yeah. It's all about humor, but.
So, all right, well.
So now where the light is blinking, we're running out of tape.
You've eaten all the tape.
Can you not interview anyone else the whole trip? That's awesome. Kirkman ruined our Comic-Con coverage. Jesus.
Well, now we're done. We can just go to the pool.
Yeah, exactly. We're going to go swimming. So
that's Kirkman saved the weekend. Woo! Everybody gets a high five.
All right. Yeah. So thanks, Robert.
Thank you, Robert.
Cameraman.
I'm just cameraman.
So... It's hard to get Kirkman to stop talking sometimes, but we definitely had a lot of fun. We always enjoy having him on the show. Hopefully you enjoyed this one. So if you enjoyed the show, head over to iFanboy.com where there'll be a thread to talk about the episode, or the forums at revision3.com/iFanboy. And don't forget to call us in on our voicemail line at 1-888-FANBOYS. That's 1-888-326-2697. Or send us an email and tell us what you think of Kirkman at contact@iFanboy.com. Thanks a lot.
I don't know anyone's names. What do you want from me? Come on.
I'm a few these.
Ron.
Oh, it's never on that ring.
Josh. All
right. It's over.
You're the iFanboy guy.
Yeah.